Assalamu alaikum, ladies and gentlemen. Nobel laureate physicist Niels Bohr once said, "Prediction is very difficult, especially if it's about the future." C.F. Kettering said, "My interest is in the future because I'm going to spend the rest of my life there." Although he spent the most of his life in the present, as this American inventor held 140 patents. It seems, ladies and gentlemen, that predicting the future event has fascinated people for long, and our topic for the next few sessions will be forecasting. As we have completed our block one, in which we learned, in unit one, we had the overview of production and operations management, unit two, production systems, issues and environment, unit three, total quality management. In block 2, we will learn about the need and importance of forecasting and the qualitative and the quantitative methods of forecasting. Our learning objectives are, when we complete our block 2, we will be able to understand the need and importance of forecasting, understand the three times horizon and which models apply for each use, explain when to use qualitative and the quantitative models, apply qualitative and the quantitative models, apply the measures of forecast accuracy, develop seasonal indexes, conduct a regression and correlation analysis, use a tracking signal. Now, our agenda for this session is global company profile of Disney World, the strategic importance of forecasting, human resources, capacity, supply chain management, 7 steps in the forecasting system, forecasting time horizons, type of forecasts, qualitative forecasting models. Now, I will request our expert, Dr. Muhammad Abbas Chaudhary, to advance our understanding.
Well, thank you, Aisha. And welcome, ladies and gentlemen, around the world, Commonwealth of Learning. Aisha reminded me when she quoted Niels Bohr and C.F. Kettering, that scientists are generally seeking perfection. And forecasting is something which leads us towards making some estimates. That reminds me a joke about a forecaster, that forecasters are the people who tell what will happen tomorrow, and tomorrow they explain why it didn't happen. I think this joke goes along with many stories, popular stories I'm sure you might have heard. For example, T.J. Watson, the legendary chairman of IBM, once said, "There may be a world market for 5 computers." And similarly, our smarter and founder of Microsoft, Bill Gates, once said, 640K ought to be enough for everybody. And similarly, Ken Olson, who was the chairman of DEC, also said, "I don't know why the people will need computers at their homes." And I think that goes along with what Aisha said, all these jokes. But ladies and gentlemen, we cannot underestimate the need for forecasting, because in forecasting, what we actually try to do is we try to increase the signal to noise ratio, where signal is something which is predictable and noise is something which cannot be generally predicted. And forecasting, we treat forecasting as a science. which we'll see during the next few sessions. Now, with this light chat, let's get to our work today. Our case study for today is Disney World. I'm sure most of you have heard about it, and some of you might have seen the Disney World theme parks in California, or in Orlando, Florida, or in Hong Kong, in Tokyo, or in Paris. Aisha, have you seen Disney World?
Yes, I have.
Okay. Even if you have not seen, I'm sure you will remember Mickey Mouse, you remember Peter Pan, Alice in the Wonderland, Bambi, and many other famous characters. If you have not seen the theme parks, at least you have seen the movies. And ABC World, who can forget about it? Ladies and gentlemen, it's very interesting that the Disney World company was created in 1923 by two brothers, Disney, Walt and Roy Disney. And since long, the company has evolved into a huge company, having 150,000 employees across the world, and theme parks, as I mentioned, in many nationalities. 2009 revenues of the company were $36 billion. And the assets of the company in 2009 were $63 billion. Huge. And you know how the company makes money? Out of people. Do you think the company can make that sort of money and can run that sort of operation without forecasting? No, let's look at how and what type of forecasts are made at Disney World. As I mentioned, the global portfolio includes parks in Hong Kong, Paris, Tokyo, Orlando, and Anaheim, California. Revenues are primarily derived from people, how many visitors and how they spend their money. It's important to forecast for the company. Now, Disney management report contains only the forecast and actual attendance at each park. Then, Disney generates daily, weekly, monthly, annual, and five-year forecasts. Forecasts are used by labor management, maintenance, operations, finance, and park scheduling. Forecasts used to adjust opening times, rides, shows, staffing levels, and guest admitted. Similarly, 20% of the customers come from outside of the United States. Every fifth person in Disney parks is not from the American citizen, but from elsewhere in the world. Economic model include gross domestic product, cross exchange rates, then arrivals into the United States, and a staff of 35 analysts and 70 people, field people, survey 1 million park guests, employees, and travel professionals each year. Inputs to the forecasting model include airline specials, Federal Reserve policies, Wall Street trends, vacations, holiday schedule for 3,000 school districts around the world. Average forecast error for the five-year forecast is 5%. Boy, that is something. Only 5% forecast error over a period of 5 years. Average forecast error for annual forecast is between 0 to 3%. I think this is the pure science. I mean, it is not the hunch of somebody. It is a pure science. Now, I think we need to define what actually forecasting is. As I mentioned, forecast is a science. There are scientific methods, tools, techniques, models, and data which is employed in order to make a forecast. What will happen during the day? What will happen over a period of 24 hours? What will happen over a period of week? And based on what business you are, based on what sort of forecasting you are trying to make, it is a science, and the scientific principles are applied. And what is critical in this is we try to increase signal to noise ratio. As I mentioned, signal is predictable, noise is what we cannot predict. Now, forecasting in business means process of predicting a future event. And time horizon is critical in that. What we really need to forecast. Forecast for the next day, forecast for the next month, forecast next week or next year, and so on. and predicting the future event to make what? Informed decisions. Decisions about production, about inventory, about personnel, about facilities. And forecasting time horizon, as I mentioned, generally we categorize forecasting time horizon in three groups: short duration forecasting, medium, and long. And short duration forecasting, your short range forecasting, is up to 1 year, generally less than 3 months. And the decision areas are purchasing, job scheduling, work levels, job assignment, production levels. Whereas the medium range forecast involve from 3 months to up to 3 years. And sales, production planning, budgeting is involved in that. And more than when we go beyond 3 years, it is what we call long range forecasting. And it involves capital, generally capital investment decisions, new plants, new locations, so on. Now, how do we distinguish between the short, medium, and long range forecast? It is very, very important to understand, Aisha, at this time. Medium range forecast deal with more comprehensive issues and support management decisions regarding planning and products, plants, and processes. Whereas short-term forecasting usually employs different methodology than the long-term forecasting. And short-term forecasts tend to be more accurate than the long-term forecasted. What are the differences? The medium and long-range forecast is generally for making long-term capital strategic decisions. Short-term decisions, we use different tools and techniques, and short-term forecasts are generally accurate. Now, I think it is important to understand. You will recall that we had the S curve, the famous S curve, what we call the product life cycle curve. Forecasting also is important and related with the product S curve or product life cycle. There is a different type of forecasting at the introduction stage, at growth, maturity, and decline stage. Introduction and growth require longer forecast than maturity and decline because you are introducing new product. And when you are introducing new product, you would like to know what, during the lifetime of the product, what sort of sales we'll be expecting. As product passes through, the life cycle forecasts are useful in projecting the staffing levels, how many people you need, how you are going to maintain the inventory, what will be the factory capacities, how are going to increase the capacities, and so on. I'm sure you've seen the slide before, the product life cycle, introduction, growth, maturity, and decline stage, and what sort of company strategies are there, then what operations management strategies are there. At growth stage, you see here, forecasting is critical, right?
Is the forecasting only applied to demand and the production forecasts only?
No, Aisha, demand and production, that relates to the manufacturing operation. Whereas forecasting is much bigger, as a subject, forecast is much bigger, and it applies to almost every sector of, I would say, economy, and generally every type of business activity, be it manufacturing, services, sales, production, operation, and even economic forecasting, for example, addresses the business cycle. It will essentially involve many years, business cycle maybe 3 years, 5 years, 10 years. Inflation rates, money supply, housing starts, and so on. I mean, means economic forecasts are also done. Then there is technological forecast. You'll recall, let's say 10 years back, what was the situation as far as mobile phone is concerned? What was the situation as far as what you call a broadband internet is concerned? It means technologies are also forecasted, and prediction rate of technological progress. How a certain given technology, be it a medical technology, be it a telecom technology, manufacturing technology, computer technology, and whatnot, how that technology is going to progress, how that technology is going to evolve, and impact how that technological developments will impact the new products, and how that will impact on economy. Then demand forecast predicts sales of the existing products and services and so on. As such, forecasts is not only about product and services, it is much bigger subject to be looked into. And forecasting is also very critical for the business decisions as it relates to human resource management. Let's say if you want to produce certain amount of goods and services, you require, in order to produce that level of goods and services, you need certain manpower, you need certain inventories, you need lots of inputs, all these inputs that go into producing a number of computers, a number of cars, a number of airplanes and whatnot. You require to make a forecast, how many people you will need and what sort of capacity will be needed. Let's say if you want to install a milk plant, you made a forecast in certain market, what will be the demand for the milk. Then you need to decide what capacity plant you should be installing, 50,000 liters a day, 100,000 liters a day, or 200,000 liters a day. Similarly, in supply chain, you require a lot of forecasting. Let's say you have n number of supplier, how much will be coming from supplier A, from supplier B, from supplier C, and what will be supplied by supplier A, B, C, from what market, from which geographical region, from which plant, and so on. All these things, I think, are very, very important. Without forecasting, you cannot predict, you cannot determine inventory levels, you cannot manage your supply chain, and you cannot manage your human resources.
Sir, we would like to know about the steps of the forecasting process.
Aisha, as I mentioned, forecasting is a very systematic and very organized process, and it will have to be the very specific systematic method will have to be applied in order to really make a forecast. The seven very important and the steps which have been defined to make a forecast are: determine the use of the forecast. Why actually you are making a forecast? You are determining, trying to determine the sales or production levels or plant capacities, or you are trying to make, let's say, an economic forecast or technology forecast. You need to first of all determine why you are going to make a forecast and where whatever forecast you are making will be used. Then select the items to be forecasted. In many cases, I mean, companies produce dozens, hundreds, and sometimes thousands of products and services. Now, you need to determine which product you are trying to forecast. Then determine the time horizon. Is it a short, medium, or long duration forecast? Then you have to select the forecasting model. Is it a quantitative model? Is it a qualitative model? Then selecting amongst the quantitative, you have to decide which model you are going to use, Delphi, or you want to use, let's say, consumer survey, or you want to have the expert opinion and whatnot. In quantitative, you want to determine, you are going to apply regression, associative model, or average, moving average, or whatever. Then you gather the data, make the forecast, and validate the forecast, whether the forecast or prediction what you have made is valid for the purpose you have developed it, and then implement the results. These are the seven steps in forecasting. You need to, in fact, again, your first comments of Neil Bohr and Kittring keeps me reminding that forecasts are never perfect. The realities are relatively different. Forecasts help us determine that this is what we should expect, but they are seldom perfect. Forecasts, most techniques assume an underlying stability in the system. Means this is the assumption that system, the prediction you are making is on certain assumptions, and you make that these assumptions will hold as the time passes, let's say next year, next quarter, or next 5 years, economic situation changes and general environmental situation changes. As such, prediction can be close, but it cannot be perfect. Product family and aggregate forecasts are more accurate than individual product forecasts. And your aggregate prediction will be rather more precise than your prediction about a single product or a single service.
Right. Sir, would you explain some forecasting methods?
Well, Aisha, yes. As I mentioned, you can categorize the forecasting models in two categories, qualitative and quantitative. In this session, we'll only discuss the qualitative methods, and these qualitative methods are generally used when the situation is vague and little data exists. For example, for the new products, it means you are trying to launch a brand new product which is new to the world. How you do not have any previous data. You have to make some judgment, you have to make some assessment that how that product or service is going to behave in the market. And when some new technology is being applied, let's say from the analog to when people went from the analog to the digital technology, digital camera, digital storage, and then digital broadcasting and so on, means you are entirely in a new situation, new product, new service, new technology, entirely a new environment. You do not have data for that, so that you could make quantitative analysis, you have to rely on the qualitative methods and involve intuition and experience, means your judgment. Then forecasting sales of unique, new to the world product or service is done by qualitative methods. And then there are some quantitative methods which are used when situation is stable and historical data exists. For existing products, current technology involves mathematical techniques, forecasting of sale, for example, color television. Means you have the data for the last 5 years, last 10 years, and the data about technology and so on. When you have historical data, then you apply quantitative models. Now I'll be explaining some of the quantitative models. For example, jury of executive opinion is one qualitative method in which pool opinion of high level experts, sometime argument by statistical methods. Then there is a Delphi method, we'll explain it further, which is the opinion of the panel of experts, which is queried iteratively. Then Salesforce composite, obviously, each company has a sales force deployed in their geographical region or in the market they serve. And estimates from individual salesperson are reviewed for reasonableness and then aggregated in order to see what will be the regional or national demand. Then consumer market survey. You actually go to the consumer, ask them about product, about service, about technology, about their buying behavior, about their buying plan, about their incomes, and so on. And based on the consumer market survey, you come up with your forecast. Now, jury of executive opinion involves small groups of high-level experts and managers, and group estimates demand by working together. Combines managerial experience with the statistical models. It is relatively quick, and I think there is an example mentioned in your Heiser book about Bristol-Myers Squibb company, which uses 220 countrywide experts in order to make forecast based on the medical research. What medical research they see will be transformed into products and services, and which product from that jury of expert opinion they make forecast about their products to be launched and the level of market. However, I think jury of executive opinion has one disadvantage, what we call groupthink disadvantage. Generally, when a group is discussing the issue, some of the group members, they try to dominate the discussion. And the people in the group, some of the members in the group, they may be changing their opinion, or they may be tailoring their opinion to based on the discussion that is going on. And that is what leads to a groupthink phenomena, which is a disadvantage as far as jury of executive opinion is concerned. The next is a Salesforce composite. Each salesperson project his or her sales. Let's say you have 100 salesperson deployed out there in the market. And in the market, each one of them develops sales estimate during the next, let's say, a quarter or during next month and so on. Combined at the district and the national level, then sales rep know customers' wants. The assumption is that sales rep know what actually customer wants, and based on the sales rep opinion, you aggregate and you try to come up with the composite, what will be actually sales be next quarter, next year, and so on for a particular product or service. However, again, the Salesforce composite has one limitation, that generally each salesperson tries to be more optimistic, tries to come up with more than what actually demand will be. As such, one need to be very careful while you are aggregating the Salesforce composite. The next qualitative method is the Delphi method. I'm sure, ladies and gentlemen, you know what a Delphi method is. Actually, it involves three groups. One is the group of decision makers and managers. The second group is the facilitators. And third group is the experts. And generally, 5 to 10 experts are involved in that. The facilitators, generally, they try to develop the questionnaire, organize the issues, and then these issues are mailed or sent to the experts, 5 to 10 experts, or even in some cases more, and then get their opinion. Their opinion, when it comes back, is analyzed by the decision makers, by the managers, and then questions are revised based on the first round. Then second round is of questions is launched and sent to the experts, and so on. It is explained in this diagram. For example, the administrative staff basically prepares the survey, which is sent to the respondent people who can make valuable judgment, and then that judgment is evaluated, or whatever response comes is evaluated by the decision makers. And based on that, the questionnaire is revised once again sent to the respondent, and again decision makers evaluate. In third or fourth or fifth iteration, generally the decision makers come up, now they have a reasonable estimate, and then that can be used as a forecast. The last but not the least qualitative method deployed in forecasting is consumer market survey. Generally, you develop a survey and then go to the people who are going to buy or not going to buy your product. You go ask them their preferences, their requirements, their income levels, or whatever is required to make the forecast.
Thank you, sir, for explaining the concepts of forecasting to our viewers. Ladies and gentlemen, in this session we discussed the forecasting at the Walt Disney World. Forecasting is very important and help us predict human resources requirements, capacity requirements, demand predictions, supply chain management. Forecasting system involves 7 steps. We define forecasting time horizons, types of forecasts, and qualitative forecasting methods, including jury of experts, Delphi method, and Salesforce composite. With this, we conclude this session. Ladies and gentlemen, see you next time with a new topic. Thank you, and Allah Hafiz.